In this video, we're given a large tube filled with water and we're using a density of 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter for that. And we've placed a metal cylinder on top of the water, and this is sealed with O-rings so the water can't leak past it. And the pressure at the top of the water column has to be sufficient to hold up that metal cylinder. So this makes the pressure greater in the water than it would be otherwise. I'm going to call that point number one at the top of the water column. Now we're going to be working in gauge pressure through this entire problem, and so I could label the pressure up here at the top of the metal cylinder as atmospheric pressure, but in the gauge pressure units, that's zero. And in part A, we're interested in computing the hydrostatic gauge pressure at the bottom of the column, and I'll call that point number two. So that's going to be the pressure at the top of the water column plus the additional rho gh component from going deeper into the fluid. Now that's while the valve is closed at the bottom of this tube, and in part B, we open that valve and we find the speed of the water coming out of the tube. I'm gonna call that point three. And just while I'm labeling things, let's make a note of the fact that P3 is equal to atmospheric pressure, which again, in gauge pressure units, is zero. So we start working on part A. We want the hydrostatic pressure at point two at the bottom of the water column. And the first thing we have to do is get the pressure at point one, which is sufficient to balance that metal cylinder. So this requires a force analysis on the metal cylinder. And the force of gravity is pulling down on that with a magnitude of mg. And then the pressure at point one is exerting a force upward on that. And I'll call that F1. Now just a quick reminder here, if we want to relate pressure to the force exerted by the pressure, we would go back to the definition pressure is force per unit area, which means you can always compute the force exerted by a fluid by taking the pressure and multiplying by the area that it's exposed to. And this means F1 is going to be equal to P1 times the cross-sectional area of that cylinder. So let's go ahead and express the fact that the forces balance on this metal cylinder. In other words, mg pointing down, it's got to be equal to P1 times A pointing up. And we're interested in solving for P1 here, so P1 is going to be mg over A, where A is the cross-sectional area of that cylinder. So we plug in the mass of the cylinder, that's 0.825 kilograms, just making a quick unit conversion to SI units. G is 9.8 meters per second squared. And then the cross-sectional area of this thing, well, it's a tube with a diameter of 5.2 centimeters, so we can use 1/4 pi times diameter squared. That's equivalent to pi times radius squared. It just doesn't require you to convert to radius first. And the diameter in SI units is 0.052 meters. Now when we run the numbers, we get 3,807 pascals, just keeping a little extra precision. And again, that's the pressure at point one at the top of the water column. Now we have to find the pressure at point two. And that's given by the pressure at the top of the water column, that's P1, plus rho gd, where d is the depth of the fluid. So we get 3,807 pascals at the top of the water column plus a 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter for the approximate density of water times 9.8 meters per second squared for little g. And then the depth in the fluid is 0.25 meters. When we run the numbers on this, we get 6,257 pascals at 0.2. And I traditionally round final answers to 3 sig figs. So this is 6,260 pascals. Now in part B, we have a fluid dynamics problem. And the idea here is to apply Bernoulli's equation in order to find V3, the speed of the fluid coming out of this little valve. We're told we can ignore all effects of friction and we can ignore the kinetic energy density in the tube itself because it's so large compared to the size of the valve. So that water's not going to be dropping very fast. And there's two different ways we could go here. One way we could go is to say that, all right, let's look at the energy density at point number two. Provided we're far enough away from that valve, the velocity of the fluid there is still going to be negligible. And then we could compare that energy density to the energy density at the opening in the valve. The other way is we could compare point number one to point number three, and either way, we're gonna get the same answer. So what I'm gonna do is illustrate what happens if you compare point number one to point number three, and then we'll show it's equivalent to comparing point number two to point number three. So our first approach is the point number one to point number three approach, and we applied Bernoulli's equation. And so there it is, and I'll post a link to where I originally discussed Bernoulli's equation. But what we're doing here is saying the energy density in the fluid is the same at these two locations, and there's three types of energy density: pressure, gravitational potential energy density, and kinetic energy density. And so at point one, we've already calculated the pressure. We'll be able to get the gravitational potential energy density with the y coordinate there, I'm going to use the simplest coordinate system I can think of, which would be putting y equals 0 at the bottom of the tube and y equals 0.25 meters at the top of the tube. And then the kinetic energy density at the top of the tube, we were already told we could approximate this away. So the tube is large compared to the valve at the bottom, so the fluid velocity is so small that we don't have to worry about the kinetic energy part. Now what about P3? That's atmospheric pressure, which in gauge pressure units gives me 0. So that one's gone. And then the gravitational potential energy density component, that's gone too, because I set up my coordinate system so that y is 0 at that location. So now we just have to solve for V3. So I multiply by 2 on both sides, divide by rho, and take the square root. So there's our general expression for V3. And we just sub our numbers into this. And P1 was 3,807 plus a rho g y1, so 1,000 times 9.8 times 0.25, all divided by the density of the fluid, approximately 1,000. Into 3 sig figs, I get 3.54 meters per second. Now, just a quick note on the other way to do it, we could have compared point number 2 to point number 3, provided we're far enough away from that valve where we don't have to think about the actual kinetic energy density in the water, as it transitions from practically motionless over on the left-hand side to moving at V3 over on the right-hand side. And what I notice in the expression that I already wrote down is that this piece in parentheses is really just P2. That's P1 plus rho GH. We already computed this thing. So if I write down Bernoulli's equation here, I have P2. I computed that in part A. My gravitational potential energy density is 0 at point number 2. My kinetic energy density is also 0, provided I stay away from that valve. P3 is still 0 because that's atmospheric pressure and we're using gauge pressure units. And then the height at point 3 is also 0. Solving for V3, I just get 2P2 divided by rho square rooted. And again, P2 is really just all of this stuff right here, the pressure at 0.1 plus rho GH. Symbolically, it's this stuff right here. So I know that number is the same when I plug it in. And this means I arrive at the same speed at 0.3. Either way, I do the problem. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.